When you've created iconic songs like Victim of Circumstance, Oh Me Oh My, I'm a Fool for You, Nothing I Can Do About It, Hang On In There, and You're Gonna Get Next to Me, what more is there to say? A son of the Mississippi Delta, born in the throes of Southern Jim Crow, Mike James Kirkland was the son of a farmer. As such, tradition said that expectations had already charted a course for him to continue the agricultural lifestyle of his father. However, though the lives of Walter and Rosa Kirkland were tethered to their farm, they were out-of-the-box thinkers nonetheless. So also would their son be. Miss Kirkland was an educator who insisted her children follow a course of learning and speaking that would allow them to present themselves properly in public. Dad was a man of stature, with an amazing sense of humor that gave him the capacity to communicate with people on all levels. Mr. Kirkland was active in the early underground stages of the civil rights movement. In fact, an organizing meeting led by soon-to-be Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, Thurgood Marshall, was held in the Kirkland's farmhouse. When a young Michael Kirkland asked his father, was he afraid to be involved in such activities? His reply was, I'm more afraid not to be.
My dad, along with a group of other people, were able to get buses because of their activity to take the students to high school. Most of the kids up until, let's say, the early 50s, when you got through the eighth grade, you were through with school because there was no high school close enough to go. So they figured out a way to get buses to drive the students into Yazoo City to what they call number two high school. Maybe 8-10 years before that, Thurgood Marshall was spearheading community meetings to form the NAACP chapters in the South to fight segregation and discrimination. The organizing meeting for the NAACP area around Jackson, Mississippi was held at my mom and dad's farmhouse. And it wasn't something that they talked about, because that was taboo. I mean, if they really, it was like clandestine meeting. It wasn't like everybody come. Just certain people were invited because of their integrity and because of their willingness to participate in the arena. And I remember as a young man, my father told me something, and this goes right back to your point. He told me, he said, I don't have any problem saying yay for Dr. Martin Luther King. He said, but we were moving this package long before he came along. He said, we were not going to take it anymore. And we were moving it. And then he started to delineate some things. And of one of those things was that meeting at the farm with Thurgood Marshall, who would become a U.S. Supreme Court Justice. Well, when you're born, you really don't know nothing. So you don't know if you're in a cool spot or you just stuck in a spot. The struggle of young Black people in the Delta was not so much that they were afraid of things, but they wanted more than was available to them. Just to give you an idea, we were literally miles from a store. So you don't get up in the morning and say, I think I'll have a Snicker and go down and pick it up. All of these kinds of things were planned, but for us, it was normal, so we didn't have anything to measure it against. That's how we lived. once we started to grow as a community, I guess is a way to say it, my older brothers and sisters started to venture out to high school, and they were actually in a city removed from us, but they would come home with these amazing encounters and stories. And then my parents would take us into the big city, which was Yazoo City, on the weekends, and we got a chance to see amazing things like movie theaters and ride on the long highway in the car. So one of the things that I remember most is that my father could get into a conversation with anybody. This guy was phenomenal in his capacity to communicate and make things go smoothly. So as long as he was around, we figured we had it made. The only problem that we had was when he wasn't around us, and there were times that his work would take him away from the house. And Charles, it was a kind of a weird kind of loneliness when he wasn't there. My mom was there, all my brothers and sisters were there, but when he put his foot on the front porch, everything seemed to calm down. But until he was home, there was this air of uncertainty. And we didn't know it was racism that we were afraid of. We didn't know that people were hurting each other. But in the midst of this dynamic of growing up, Emmett Till was murdered in Mississippi. And it scared me unbelievably. I can't even tell you how frightened I was, because there was a white farmer who was right next to the junior high school, to the school that we went to, the elementary school that we went to. And one day the ball went out from the school and I ran over into the yard to pick it up, and he was standing on the porch looking at me, and I knew he was coming to get me tonight, and when the night came. But I wouldn't tell my father because I was afraid that my father might do something and he would get it in it. But anyway, long story short, those were the kind of dynamics that were the backdrop of what you call the blues. Elvis Presley's family lived two farms down from us, and Elvis used to come into our community as a young boy. My brother, older brother, played guitar with B.B. King. So those kinds of dynamics are real. They were all there together, and as long as you were little kids, you could play interracially. They didn't care enough about little kids playing together. But by the time you got to be a teenager, they didn't want you anywhere around. Of course, you don't understand the reason that young boys and young girls become attracted to each other at that point. But that severed the so-called interracial attitude at that time.
It is apparent Mike inherited that courageous social consciousness, as evidenced by the songs he would later compose. Raising seven children, five of them sons, in the Jim Crow Deep South was a trying task for his parents. Still, it was obvious early on there was something special about Mike Kirkland.
I was just always singing. I do remember, this sounds funny to say it this way, but when other people started to envy or say things or make jealousy and talk about my son can sing too, why you make him sing all the time? That's when I realized that I had to hold my own, I guess is a good way to say it. I had to protect who I was and what I was doing. So in the gospel churches, in the Baptist churches, people really want to hear good singing. And I was always asked to sing. So that's how I started to understand that the choir directors were always looking for songs for me to sing. That's when I started to realize, hey man, I must be pretty good at this stuff. We started a five-man group when we were about 12, somewhere around 12, 13 years old. And I was the lead singer. There was another group that I was involved with, was a mixed group. It was two girls and two boys. And we used to swing things around, but I wound up most of the time singing a lead in that group too.
As a six-year-old, Mike's vocal talents were extraordinary enough for him to be chosen as a lead singer for the Rose Hills Missionary Baptist Church Choir. Growing up in Yazoo City, Mike, his sister Jerry, and brother Robert sang in musicals around the church circuit. The congregation was amazed how Mike inherited the outstanding voice of singer Sam Cooke. Throughout his growing musical experience, Mike Kirkland was enamored by the sounds of Sam Cooke and the Soul Stirrers.
We had a choir, and the church was called Rose Hills Missionary Baptist Church. My brother and sisters were already singing, and by the time I was 5 or 6, because we sang at the house all the time, they taught me how to sing by the time I could hardly stand up. So we were singing and singing. We had a radio station down there that was a 50,000 watt. So it came out of Nashville, but it blasted into our house really well. And we could hear Nat King, and we could hear Sam Cooke and the Soul Stirrers, the Five Blind Boys, and all those people were blasted in our ear. So we would mimic them. We figured if you have to sing, might as well sing like Sam Cooke. And I fell in love with that voice. And because I was still young, I had the highest pitch of the family. So my sister would sing the other role, the other part, and then I would sing Sam Cooke. And we traveled all around singing. My older brothers had a group called the Seven Seals Junior. And they actually had a radio show on Sunday mornings. They would go into the big city, Yazoo City. My father produced the show. And they would sing, man. And they were well known around the circuit, to the point where professional gospel groups would come to our church and other churches around. And we would follow them around like you follow the Temptations or Impressions or Four Tops. You just want to go see the good singers. So we did that around, and they used to have a fundraiser component called the Queen Drive. And the young girls would be asked to participate. So they would pick 5, 6 girls. And then once they picked them, they had to go out and see who could get the most money. So my sister was always picked, but she didn't go looking for any money because we wanted her to lose on purpose so we could sing on the show. And I can still remember her bashfully saying, "Well, I didn't get much money, and I know I'm gonna have to sing, and I'm sorry, but if you can give me a chance to sing with my brothers, because I'm shy to sing all by myself, we'll gladly do that number. That's the penalty for not raising money." Man, she would pick that microphone up. She would blow them out the church. And that's how we got our start as far as singing is concerned. To tell the truth, we had no other orientation. That was our recreation. We could play baseball and all that other stuff. We were good at it. We were great athletes. But at night, when the next farm is 1.5 miles down the road and you don't have no TV, what you gonna do? You gonna sing some songs. And we sang them. And thank God we learned how to sing them pretty well.
When Mike entered the public school system, it was housed in one large building where all 8 grades assembled to be taught by a single teacher who rotated from grade to grade throughout the day. It is amazing he could emerge from such a quaint setting to become a music artist revered the world over. Once the two older Kirkland boys grew into manhood, they decided not to follow in their father's footsteps as farmers, leaving Mississippi to head west. But it wouldn't be a longing for change that would drive Mike and the rest of his family from the South. The next eldest Kirkland boy fell prey to the violence of Jim Crow when he was attacked at the age of 16.
He actually had carried that ball about as well as you can, because he got two boys up and out. They moved, took the diaspora move and went north. The next boy actually drove that bus I was telling you about that took the kids into Yazoo City to get the to get their higher education. One day the bus broke down and he took it and to the mechanics, because the white school and the black school buses all were taken care of. The maintenance was for all of them together. And the mechanic asked my brother, why did he break the bus, with some expletive kind of things. And my brother said, sir, I didn't break the bus. It's just an old bus and it broke down. And he took a wrench and hit my brother in the face. And as when he was hitting him, one of the other dudes said that they should kill the N-word. And he ran until he could get to a safety, because we did have family members in that part of the town. After that, my father pretty much concluded that he had fought as well as he could fight, that he had offered as much for his children's safety that he could. So that's when he decided to move us from Yazoo City area, and we came to California in 1956. But he put us in that car, hooked the U-Haul trailer behind it, and my brother drove us to California.
The attack proved to be the impetus that caused Walter Kirkland to decide it was time to flee the tensions of protecting his children from the random violence that so often awaited blacks in the South. In the late 1950s, Walter and Rosa sold the farm, gathered up their remaining children, loaded them into a car owned by one of their sons, and with a U-Haul in tow, headed for California. Suddenly, a 10-year-old Mike found himself in Los Angeles.
That's where we met that's where we went to Menlo Avenue School, then we went to Mount Vernon Junior High School, and out of that we went to Dorsey. It was a weird kind of situation, because when I got to California, I was in sixth grade, because I had been accelerated back in Mississippi. They said that I didn't need to keep going through the same stuff that I already knew, so they moved me a grade ahead, depending on how I could perform at the time. Anyway, when we got to California, I was in the sixth grade. And we went to an integrated school called Menlo Avenue School on 42nd Street in Menlo in Los Angeles. And it was peculiar, would be a strange thing to say. It was really strange adaptation. There was one girl who had was enrolled, I think she was from Germany. She couldn't speak any English at all. Then we had Spanish people who spoke Spanish all the time. And I chuckled, because the first quote unquote girlfriend that I had in Los Angeles was a Latino girl. And I thought at the time that I had died and gone to heaven, because she looked like Annette Funicello from the Mickey Mouse Club. And I was a baller, man. I thought I had absolutely won anything that was any victory to be won, I thought I had won it. We used to talk on the telephone. She lived in Aliso Village. And I lived on Adams and Crenshaw. And we used to talk on the telephone hours and hours and hours at the time. But she was kind of a nexus to me that helped me kind of get socialized in a new environment of integrated school. I'd never gone to school with anyone other than Black kids before. People say you just had to be there. And the more I tried to verbalize these experiences, the more I'm led back to you just had to be there. It's really no way to explain the fear. It's like paralyzing, but you still go forward. I don't know if you've ever seen a snake or if you're afraid of snakes, but it's like seeing a snake in the way, but you got to go past where that snake is. And you don't get to just sit and wait because there's a bear behind you, and that's euphemistically. But you have to move along with your life. And how do you explain that? Other than you just have to do it. Okay. And how you feel that day, that's not important.
At the age of 11, Mike joined the St. Andrew's Missionary Baptist Church Youth Choir. He was also lead singer of a group that included Jerome Rice and his brother Howard, who would later be part of the cast of the hit TV show Room 222, starring actress Denise Nicholas.
So when I got to Dorsey High School, I was involved with a choir that had some of the renowned rhythm and blues people up and coming. They weren't at that time, they were still high school students, but they would develop into really well-known professional musicians and entertainers. And also one of the choir members, I mean the choir director over our youth choir, she had a son named Mel Carter. Mel Carter had a million selling record. And Mel would come to our church and sing with us in our musicals. And we would have these battles. And I mean, when I say battles, I don't mean it in a derogatory sense. But we would bring out the very best that we could in each other. And I think that that's when I got to understand that this voice is as good as a voice that could sell a million records.
Years later, at Dorsey High School, Mike sang in the school choir with classmates like musical genius Billy Preston and Grammy-winning producer, arranger, and songwriter Jerry Peters, who wrote hits such as Going in Circles.
You got me going in circles.
And Love or Let Me Be Lonely for the Friends of Distinction. Peters also produced albums by the Silvers and worked with Earth, Wind, and Fire, Aretha Franklin, Quincy Jones, Al Green, Marvin Gaye, Natalie Cole, and others. Another Kirkland classmate and fellow choir member was Clarence McDonald, who gained notoriety for playing keyboards on the Jackson 5 hit, I Want You Back. He was musical director for The Fifth Dimension, wrote and produced the hit Silly for Denise Williams, while writing, producing, and contributing his genius to thousands of songs as a much sought after musician.
You're not thinking I'm building a legacy. I'm with people that's gonna blow the world up. We're just teenagers, you know, like when you go to high school at 14. I was singing in the choir at church, and when I saw choir on the classes, I just checked it off so they could put me in choir. I didn't know Billy Preston at the time. I didn't know Clarence McDonald at the time. I didn't know Jerry Peters. We were all just coming onto the campus. But we would have a Christmas assembly, they called it. And the the choir would come to work. I mean, in other words, we would entertain the students. But they used to have these special little segments called speakeasy or stuff like this. And Billy and Clarence and these cats, they played piano and they used to play all this jazz. Man, that was like heaven to me. We did all of the jazz thing, man. And Ron Townsend could sing, you know, they had a big old voice like Prysock, and he would sing and we would sing behind him and then everybody would get a little piece. And that was the joy, but we didn't have any idea that we had what it takes or knew anybody that could take us to the next level, except for Billy. Billy was already a child prodigy when he came to Dorsey. He had done movies and played with Ray Charles and all that stuff, but he was such a meager, meek kind of guy. He just melted in. He wasn't braggadocious. He didn't tell me, I got to sing this part, you got to listen. Everybody just had a ball as a community. So by the time we were getting ready to be 16 or 17 years old, Billy was already breaking into the music industry. And then we thought, well, if Billy can do it, we can do it. We all kind of went our separate ways from high school. Ron would go and become a member of the Fifth Dimension. Billy would be the Fifth Beatle. Clarence McDonald, man, this cat has written and produced for almost every artist that you can name. Jerry Peters did all the Barry White stuff. Jerry did Mary Mary, and Jerry and I wind up going to church at Maranatha Community Church after, you know, in our adult life. And Clarence played all my sessions. So you got me kind of dumbfounded right now when I think about you can't plan this. I mean, you don't sit down and say, I'm going to go to school with guys who's going to run the world. And these people are major, major players in the entertainment industry. You know, I'm involved with a project of bringing some old music around that James Gatson played on. James Gatson is the most recorded drummer in R&B history. And if I pick up the telephone and call him, he answers the phone, we laugh and joke and we talk. So I've been afforded some amazing experiences to know people that are world renowned. And I understand that you say that I'm in this legacy group, and I'm humbled by the fact. But man, James Gaskin can play the drum so good until he can make a record all by himself. Right. Clarence sit down to the keyboards, Bird stopped by to listen.
Amazingly, the Mike James Kirkland music story may never have happened. At 16 years old, he was known not only for his voice, but also for his prowess on the baseball field. His gifts on the ball diamond had young Kirkland traveling on an area all-star team that included future major leaguers Willie Crawford, Lee May, Bob Watson, and Bobby Tolan. Mike's power hitting was so prodigious that a scout from the then perennial champion New York Yankees tracked him down with an offer to play pro baseball. Kirkland calmly told the Yankees that he was not interested. I had played so much baseball growing up that I was sick of it. Besides, the bleachers at our school baseball games were almost empty, While the stands at basketball games were packed with fans, many of them pretty girls, basketball was my love, said Mike.
Quite honestly, that wasn't my major talent, so to speak. I was probably more athletic than I was able to sing. But my body was weird in that I was good baseball size, but not so good basketball size, but good enough basketball size to be tempted to want to be a basketball player, but more than a baseball player. You know, the same scout that scouted them came and invited me to play in the league. And I told him no. I was just not even interested anymore in playing baseball. My younger son, David, somehow he heard the story about me not wanting to play baseball anymore. So one day, in one of those real serious moods that fathers and sons have, he said, "You know, Dad?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Do you believe in time machines?" I said, "No, not really." He said, "But what if I could get a time machine?" I said, "That would be probably an exciting thing to do, Dave." He said, "I wish I could, because here's what I would do." I said, "What you'd do?" He said, "I would take you and me, and we would go back to the time when you told the New York Yankees no to playing baseball." And he looked me straight down the face. He said, "I would kick your ass." That was his favorite team in all the world. And that tickled me so hard. What am I going to say? Wash your mouth out. But that was phenomenal that he dropped that on me like that. And if you could see serious in the dictionary, that look he had that day, that's the picture next to the word serious in the dictionary. He was blown away that his stupid daddy didn't go play baseball for the New York Yankees.
Coming from a very dedicated Christian family, reserved Sunday for attending church and not much else, Mike remembers the one and only time his mother attended one of his baseball games. He promptly rewarded her attendance by ripping a home run. Mike also wrote his first song around that time. It was called "Oh Patty." The song was written for a girl that used to walk past his house on her way to the store. As fate would have it, she would turn out to be the girl he took to his grad night at Disneyland. As a freshman in college, his trips to Santa Monica City College would take Mike past a popular night spot known as the Parisian Room.
I was singing every now and then at a place called the Parisian Room, which is a jazz club over on La Brea and Washington. And Robert found out that I was doing the so-called celebrity night. And he said, "Man, you're singing for free." I said, "Well, they don't pay nobody celebrity night." He said, "Nobody gets paid on celebrity night." He said, "But they still charge people to come in the club." He said, "You working for free and they're making money on you coming in. What kind of sense does that make, Mike?" I said, "Oh, Robert, I'm just having a little fun." He said, "Look, your voice is much too good to have fun with. If you ain't getting paid for that voice, don't sing." I said, "Whoa." He said, "I'm going to show you that we're going to do this thing." So the next thing I know, now we got more people coming in to be in the group. It was August when he made that bet. There was no group in August. By November, we cut a record called "Victim of Circumstance." We put it on the radio, and he won his bet. And I've been living my brother's dream ever since. He thinks the world of my talent. And he just believes that any name singer that you can mention, my name needs to be up there with it. And I've never been convinced that he's absolutely right, but I'm a pretty good singer. I sing in tune, and there's a style, I guess you can say, that is a bit unique from other people who sing. So he was right to take this commodity and market it, and he did a pretty good job with it.
Though getting paid for his talent never entered Mike's mind, it certainly crossed Robert's. While attending a party one night, Robert declared his brother could out-sing all the artists on records. He then made a bet with friends he could produce a song as good as the ones they were listening to. I know you've been writing songs for fun. Now let's write them to make money.
Like I said, my brother and my sister and I, we sang all the time. So the question never was, could we do it, in his mind. The question was, okay, so why haven't we done this yet? Because he watched our dad produce the radio show. Dad was an entrepreneur of sorts. He also was a farmer. So Robert went into business as an electrical contractor. So he was an entrepreneur in spirit as well. So he was at a party one night, and they were just raving about the Motown records. So my brother said, "Oh man, that ain't nothing. They aren't the only people that can sing. Other people can sing too." So it got to a point where he said, "I can make a record just as good as any of these records that you all are all hyped up about." Dude said, "No, you can't. I bet you can't do that." He said, "How much you want to bet?" Now, I never knew how much the bet was, and I wasn't at the party. But he came home the next day, and he called me and told me, "Mike, write a song." I said, "Man, you better get off my phone. I don't write no songs. What are you talking about?" He said, "I remember you wrote that song for that girl that come walking by the house when you were a teenager. Here I am busted. How you say no to a guy who knows your history?" So I stalled him as long as I could. Next day I get a phone call. He said, "I'm gonna come pick you up. We're going to have a meeting." I said, "Meeting? At night?" He said, "Yeah, we're going to a meeting." So we went to my sister Jerry's house, and he had arranged a meeting with her, her husband, another guy named Prentice, me and him. We were five people. And he explained the project, and everybody said, "Oh yeah, that should be fun." And we sang a little bit and doo-wop the bop bop and had some fun at the house. And then we had two or three more meetings. And my sister was pregnant at the time. So she said, "Look, I really enjoy what y'all are doing, but I'm not gonna be able to do this two things at the same time. So I'm gonna have to back out." Well, when she backed out, she took her husband with her. And Prentice said his wife wasn't happy with him not being around and going out every night. So the group kind of dissolved after about a month. So I'm thinking, wow, well, I don't have to worry about this no more.
3 months later, Victim of Circumstance could be heard on the radio, produced by Robert Big Bob Kirkland, all 6'6" of him. The song was performed by Mike and the Censations, a group created by Robert, putting together his sister Jolene, Armand Postel, and his younger brother, Mike James Kirkland, on lead vocals. Robert released the song on his record label, Brian Records, named in honor of his two-year-old son.
When we first started as Mike and the Censations, we were California, Los Angeles, California group, and we did the sock hop Hunter Hancock from KGFJ Radio would have us at several of the high schools around Southern California. And I remember that we literally got pulled off the stage at Fremont High School. That was the first inkling that what we were doing as Mike and the Censations, people love what we did. I remember our first gig was in San Diego, California, and the disc jockey was named Ron Johnson at the time. He was the blow up soul guy in San Diego. And he was the first market that broke the Victim of Circumstance record. And they wanted us to come and do a Sunday night appearance. We went down and we thought we were just going to drop in, sing a song or two, and get out of there. And between the time we finished and we were packing to leave, he said, "Where you guys going?" He said, "We're going home. We only said we were going to do one set." He said, "Man, if you guys don't sing again, they're going to tear this club down." So we just kind of chuckled like, "Yeah, right." He said, "Look, man, you got to save me. You can't leave me hanging out here." I said, "Okay." So we went back to the stage. And of course, the second set merged into the close. Like, we were going off just as the club was closing. So we were breaking to the dressing room, planning to snatch up and run out. And all of a sudden, these people start following us to the dressing room. My first thought, not ever having this kind of experience before, was, man, what did we do wrong to these people? How did we make them mad enough that they want to chase us? And it turned out that, of course, it was that adoration kind of autographs and touching and all that kind of thing that goes along with it. But it was like finger in the electric socket. Wow, we are no longer the guys who sit and watch. We're the people that they sit and watch and expect certain things out of. And there's a certain payback that goes along with it. But I will never forget that night. It was an amazing night as far as us coming into the realization that we were the artist, no longer the audience. It all started on a farm in Mississippi, man. On a farm in Mississippi. My daddy told me when I cut Victim of Circumstance, he said, "You're gonna be all right now, boy." Let me preface that. We had a musical that I told you that we were dealing with Mel Carter and them. So after the church service, when we were on the way home, my dad looked back and told me, said, "You're going to sing one day." And I thought, I said, "Didn't I just sing today?" And he just left it hanging out there. He never, ever, ever said another word about that thing other than, "You're going to sing one day." When I cut Victim of Circumstance, he said to me, "You're singing now, boy." And that was probably the greatest compliment that I ever, ever, ever got. Because in context, you're gonna sing one day and you're singing now, now the bookends fit. We did a show once with Tina Turner. Tina whipped us so bad until she made us the entertainers that we are today. We were up there doing the little sippy dippy dippy do that we thought we could be slick with. We thought we had our fans and all that kind of stuff. Man, Tina and I come out there, boo doo doo doo. And them girls, my cats, man, they forgot we were even in the house, not on the stage. They didn't even remember we came. And I said, me and Ben Roberts said, "We got to go to the woodshed." we got to hurry up and get to the woodshed, because if this is what we're up against, we got to raise it up 8-10 levels. Every night, man, every night, we tore up his carpet, but we danced and sang and danced and sang and danced and sang until we got it up to where we wasn't scared of nobody anymore. But that lady, Tina Turner, she was for real, is for real, always been for real. But she was the sweetest person when you were around her. She was just so kind and gentle, meek. But boy, you hit that band fire up, she became a whole tornado. And it was amazing to watch her, but she was a catalyst, one of those stepping stones for us.
Victim of Circumstance and other Mike James Kirkland songs like Nothing I Can Do About It and Oh Me, Oh My, I'm a Fool for You not only became mainstream hits, they also became classics to the low and slow community of lowriders who cruise boulevards in their modified cars with hydraulic lifts, custom paint jobs that often tell stories, and powerful sound systems that can be heard blocks away, as evidenced by how many of his songs ended up on record collections like East Side Story. Lowriders love the music of Mike James Kirkland.
One thing, I'm sorry I didn't mention it. Earlier you were talking about the slow and low community. Well, there's a unique slow and low community here in Las Vegas. We did a turkey giveaway for Thanksgiving. And they asked me to come over. So we were there, and then they asked me to do a song, but they didn't have any device to play the track that I had. So I sang Victim of Circumstance a cappella, and the reaction was amazing. It was like phenomenal. It was amazing to me that I could still do that without any music around. But the fact is that is the beginning, so to speak, of the professional career. And it still demands attention today. And I just wanted to leave you with that it is alive and well.
It's obvious, and not for his brother Robert, Mike may have never ventured into the professional music industry. To his credit, Robert Kirkland not only gave his brother a start in the music industry, but also jump-started the careers of drummer James Gatson, who would become one of the most recorded drummers in R&B history. Bassist Ron Brown, who played on songs by dozens of star artists, including Marvin Gaye. Keyboardist and arranger Hence Powell, whose client list is a virtual who's who in music. And guitarist Al McKay, who would wind up as a guitarist for Earth, Wind & Fire. These musicians, producers, and arrangers were part of the talented consortium of music artists Bob Kirkland called MMM, his magic music makers.
Well, Victim of Circumstance, there was a band called the Roger Spotts Band that worked out of a place called the Grants Music Center. And everybody that we had tried to get to do work with us on that thing told us that we can't do it because the music was not even. We had a odd phrase on the Victim of Circumstance. Well, Spots came and worked with us, and Harris did the arrangement. And we went into the studio. The band had one take, and we had one vocal take, and we were out of town. Now, Calvin Harris was the engineer, and Calvin left that studio and went to work for Motown. He said that he had never seen anybody cut a record that quick. He was amazed by it. But fast forward to There's Nothing I Can Do About It, we gave the arrangement to a bass player that was working in our little organization called the Magic Music Makers. His name was Ron Brown. The people on this session, Wow Wow on guitar, Charles Wright on guitar, Church Ed Green on drums, Ron Brown playing the bass, and the dude that produced all of the Lionel Richie hits, Mr. Carmichael, was on keyboards. And that's when I started to believe that Robert can do anything. I mean, here I am, some nobody singer, cutting his second record, and the most sought after session musicians in Hollywood is on my date. From there on, we pick up Al McKay, James Gadson, Ray Jackson, Hence Powell, the horn section, Thurston Love, Buddy Collette. I mean, come on, man. Ron was actually called the Motown West Coast bass player. He played on the Jackson Fives. He played on Diana Ross. He played Marvin Gaye's Trouble Man. He played everybody. He was just in every session. He played with the Fifth Dimension. It was everybody that is anybody that's got a record. Ron plays something on it. I don't want to peek anybody's home card, but some of these guys weren't the guys that they are now when Robert gave them a chance to play.
Right.
Al was just getting started, so to speak. But he could play with such fire until once you heard him play, you say, well, I want to have some of that. Gatson told me about 3 years ago, and I didn't really remember it exactly that way, that he was friends with Al and Ray Jackson. And that's how he came to know who we are. And they were able to get him on one of our sessions. And then Robert and Gat just kind of hooked up and they stayed there all along. But Ray Jackson, man, Ray Jackson was such an amazing arranger. I remember we have a song called You're Living a Lie. We did it on the Uni label. And the horns are so amazing until they sound like bells. I mean, the way he voiced those horns, the cat, he was just phenomenal. And of course, you know, he went on to work with the Watch 130 Rhythm Band plus Bill Withers and other people, but man, he was just incredible. We went to college together. That's how I met Ray. So I guess going to school was good for me because somehow or another at school, I was running into all these musicians. In college, I met Ray. I went to college with Jessica Cleese from Friends of Distinction. This may sound funny, but it was a little entertainment farm around where I lived. Everywhere I turned, somebody was challenging me to do that thing. And I remember the first time that I saw Billy Preston pull this trick. He used to take a matchstick and push it between the organ keys to hold the note down. And he would get up and dance. And people were just amazed. They said, oh, what can he do? How did he do that?
After Mike had recorded 10 singles as Mike in the Censations, he decided to go out on his own. One of the enticing promises made to him was that he could be a jazz singer. Still having an affinity for Sam Cooke and his legendary performances like Live at the Copacabana, Mike also remembered as a little boy watching Nat King Cole's television show before he'd head off to play baseball on Saturdays. These memories made that invitation to sing the kind of sweet, intimate soul music that had been festering in Mike James Kirkland for a long time very attractive.
But I liked jazz. And again, Sam Cooke and Nat King Cole and Billie Holiday, Dinah Washington. Man, Dinah Washington could sing so good. Nancy Wilson, all these people would make me say, wow, I should try to do that. And then I'd go play baseball, or I'd go play basketball. So I was detracted from the singing because sports had a greater immediate consequence to me. I mean, you hit a home run, bam, you just hit it. You don't have to wait next week, figure out if you're gonna hit another one. You hit it and you enjoyed that one today. Those singing things were, I guess, a long way out there kind of prospects that you had to work on that at that young age, I didn't feel like doing that kind of planning and working.
After his venture into doo-wop, Mike started writing songs that were not expected from a young black singer. Black singers of the day got to sing love songs or dance songs, but never significant songs. Where's the Soul of Man was a song Mike had written when he was with Mike and the Censations. The B-side of the LP was filled with love songs that Robert and Mike thought would drive the success of the album. While brainstorming, the two men decided to reach back for Where's the Soul of Man.
Where is the soul? Where is the soul? I want to know, where's that peace?
I never wanted to be a doo-wop, rock and roll, rhythm and blues singer. I wanted to sing jazz. And one of the promises that Robert made is that if you sing these rock and roll, R&B, doo-wop songs, I'll produce some jazz on you. So after our experience with Uni, when we did Living a Lie and Straw That Broke the Camel's Back, Gonna Try to Get You Back. I thought Gonna Try to Get You Back was about as good as a record could be. But one of the other parts of the entertainment industry that's not talked about is how well you're promoted. And we signed with Uni on their review label at the same time that Neil Diamond signed with the Uni label. And he gobbled up all the production money, all the promotion money. So our records were out there just kind of floating around, falling, doing the best they could. But after three releases, we agreed to go our separate ways. We first went back and sat down and had a session, and we cut a record called The Prophet. And it was, I thought, the classic record. I thought we were getting ready to blow it up. And it was funky, up-tempo, man. It was what I really, really, really loved. I mean, it had me like goose pimples. And on the backside, we put a song called Together, which was a ballad. More in our, what they call, what we were known for, our ballad singing. So we went to a record label, and it was owned by Jose Wilson. Jose Wilson was the production man and A&R guy that got Barry White started, got him up and going, promoted all his records. He had another guy on his label called David T. Walker, which was a guitar player extraordinary. He was unbelievable guitar player. I'm sure you heard of David T. Walker. We got double crossed because when Jose said, yeah, he wanted to sign us to that label. He turned right around and flipped the record over and played together. I said, oh man, you can't trust these people. They don't know nothing about no record business and what hit record is. Long story short, it was a one kind of lease record deal with them. Together was an okay record. It did all right. But I was just confused as to why they didn't flip it over. So we left that label and we did about five really solid R&B records. And they were all love songs. So we were sitting down, my brother and I, we were saying, man, this is outstanding. Why don't we do an album now rather than 45s? Because FM stereo radio became a big deal right then. So we were playing to the evolution of the industry, but we only had five songs. We had, when I was with Mike and the Sensations, it's really funny because I was actually walking down Crenshaw Boulevard and I started to sing a song because it was in the revolutionary hippie kind of concept, because people were mean to each other. And I started to wonder, where's the soul of man? What happened to neat, common, be nice to me, I'll be nice to you? And I said, where's the soul of man? And then I just sang a little down the road, and then I finally got to finishing the song. We recorded it while we were still miking the Sensations, but it didn't come out how we wanted it to come out. So we just laid it aside. We had a track that had been laying around with nothing, but it was one of those really groovy tracks. It was just really groovy. Ooh, do, 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 do. Do, da, be, da, 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 da. So I took it and I put new lyric to it. What have we done? What have we done? What have we done? What have we done? So we figured we got two songs, but we still don't have a title for the album. Slangs and colloquialisms and things like that are catchy. So we said, man, we need to find something that will catch people's ear. And I came up with the phrase, I says, how about hang on in there? He said, yeah, that'll work. Let's work that. Now I'm gonna tell you something that probably nobody ever knew. I was on one phone, Robert on another phone, and he cross-connected Ray Jackson. On the phone that night, we wrote Hang On In There. As far as the musical concepts, and Robert gave him the chord changes that he wanted and how to meter it out. Robert gave him the idea of going to the 12/8 time in the middle of the song and then back to the 4/4 time. So Ray is saying, man, this is weird. You don't ever do this before. Weird, but I said, Ray, let's just follow it, man. Let's do it. And most of all, keeping the flavor that this is not the typical R&B kind of thing. This is jazz. We're gonna do a jazz fusion kind of thing. So we got the session, right? We go to the session. And Ray breaks out the charts. And I go in the vocal booth and we started to bring down Hang On In There. It was like being a, like an out-of-body experience or something. And by the time we got the string arrangements put on and the backgrounds in, that song was so phenomenal. It was so unique. And the story, for the first time, I had written three separate verses that weren't trying to connect to each other. So when I started out saying there ain't no time for sorry, ain't no time to be sad, that story was finished when we got to Hang On In There turn. Then the next one was how many times that you hear your mom and daddy say, oh child, I never had it so good. That was a story. And once it was finished, it went back to the hook, it was over. The next one was, say tomorrow you woke up a king, tell me how would you fix everything? It was a whole complete story in itself. And then the part that became amazing to us was that the turn, like there's plenty of things still left to live for, a child, a friend, and a wife. They still want to share your life. Ain't that enough to make you want to hang on in? We were sailing right along. And then when we did the change to the speed, then came the narration part. And it says, the sign says, America, love it or leave. Has it really come to that? That portion of that song, and I didn't dare tell Robert I didn't have it all finished when we went to the studio. I didn't want him chasing me down Sunset. Freestyle, man, that whole section was freestyle. Never written down, never ever on a pen. I mean, on a piece of paper. And I'm just amazed that my mind would work those lyrics and that my musical mind would hook those melodies and things together to the extent that you heard the song. But it was an incredible experience. And it became the title song for the album, Hang On In There. It blew up in the underground college market and jazz stations loved it. So my brother had promised me I could sing some jazz. He let me sing some jazz.
They also had a nice track which became the song, What Have We Done? Still needing a catchy title for the album, they decided on the phrase, Hang On In There.
Don't give up. Hang on in there. There ain't no time, no time for sorrow.
Hang On In There became more than the duo could ever have imagined. The arrangements, song, and concept album became an anthem for underground movements and college students. But the major label shunned them, saying the album's ideas and that of Marvin Gaye on his album, What's Going On, were too similar. Some even said that they had copied Marvin Gaye, though Mike had written his songs long before he heard What's Going On. The song Hang On In There would later take on a life of its own, going on to win a Grammy when it was covered by John Legend and The Roots in 2011.
It's interesting because the term pigeonhole is absolutely applicable to what happened to that song, to that album. I did an interview in Europe a little while ago. And one of the guys asked me, he said, so where did you get the courage to say America, love it or leave it? I said, I didn't necessarily think it was so courageous as just a reflection of, in other words, I was just reading a news story. I wasn't writing the news, I was reading the news. And he said, what would have happened if Columbia or one of the other major labels had jumped on that, like Motown jumped on? I said, you know, Barry didn't really want Marvin to cut that record.
Right, exactly.
He told him, man, you're wasting my time with this stuff. Go cut me some How Sweet It Is so we can go make some more money. And Marvin was able to win out. And the funny thing about it is that when we take black people into a white record company and talk bad about America, they probably ain't gonna take that record either. And I didn't realize that until 20 years after the record had come out. Actually, it was 30 years after the record came out. And I said, you know, now I know why they were turning it down. They weren't turning it down because it was bad. They were turning it down because they did not want to take that story to white radio stations, expecting them to play it because they weren't ready to put that out in the air. That was my 40-year reflection of hang on in there. And then John Legend and Questlove. Funny thing about it, there's a guy over in England called Giles Peters. And he's the hip hop disc jockey king over there. But somehow or another, he fell in love with Hang On In There. He's the person that introduced it to Questlove. And it won a Grammy. I mean, again, you don't wake up on the Mississippi Turn Road saying, hey, I'm gonna go win a Grammy.
Hang On In There was originally recorded as the title track of a 1972 album by R&B singer Mike James Kirkland. Roots drummer Amir Khalid Thompson, known professionally as Questlove, said to Billboard magazine, it's a song that deals with patriotism, which connects to what's going on in New York with the mosque near Ground Zero. Hang On In There deals specifically with the definition of an American. Do you consider me an African American like you consider yourself an American? Every day, new subjects and ideas are being raised that make this album relevant. John Legend added, Hang On In There is really about who's American. Whose country is it? Even though black people have had a very difficult relationship with America and have had the best and worst of America, we still feel like we are American. This is our country too. Legend said these words in an interview for The Guardian, written by Angus Beatty.
I don't know. It's a blessing. Sometimes it seems like I'm looking at some other guy because it just it's like, who is that guy? I mean, I'm still trying to learn who he is, just like everyone else is. But some of the times I'm amazed at the lyrics, some of the things that come out of the pen, they are kind of dumbfounding. So I know it ain't me because I ain't that smart. But the lyric is probably the key to it all, just been the lyric.
In 1975, Mike James Kirkland became Bo Kirkland and teamed up with former Iket Ruth Davis on Claridge Records.
Well, we were in the studio at Hollywood Sound. Jesse Hodges and us with Campbell. And Jesse was the kind of guy that the people would come around him. So he said, you know what? I have a friend that has a record label, but you guys should talk to him because he's looking for artists and you guys are making some pretty awesome music. So Glenn Campbell said, man, you guys sound great. So we met Frank Slay. And we were hoping that Frank would pick up the Hang On In There album and the Doing It Right album and promote it himself. The first thing he said was, you know, guys, Mike Jackson just left the Jackson 5 and he's using the name Michael Jackson. He said, I would hope that you understand, but we can't run up against Michael. So we're gonna do this deal. We're gonna have to get a new name for Mike Kirkland. He said, the Kirkland part is outstanding, but we gotta find something in front of it. So my first reaction is that you ain't my daddy and my mama. I said, my daddy and my mama named me Mike Dan Kirkland. But we worked it through and we came up with the name Bo Kirkland. And rather than taking the old records and keeping them going, he said, we can cut music. You guys are good enough to make those records. You can make other records. So we sat down, Frank, me, and Hintz, and we worked on a song that he had given the title for. And he said he wanted to have a song about a grandfather clock. And I'm thinking, a grandfather clock, man, don't nobody know nothing about no grandfather clock. I ain't got no grandfather clock in my house. And then we laughed it off and we went and cut the record. Well, it charted. It jumped into R&B charts. And we were getting ready to move to another project when he asked us to do some work with Ruth Davis to get her initial record. So we worked with her for a while and we had a couple songs that she liked and we liked and Frank liked. And he said, you know what? Freddie Hart has a song that I believe that you and Ruth could kill together. I said, so what's the song? I said, I didn't know Freddie Hart wrote R&B. He said, nah, he doesn't write R&B. This is a country song. So I was smart enough to keep my mouth shut. But I went home and said, man, this cat has lost his mind. I ain't singing no R&B. I ain't singing no country western song with no chick. It's enough that I got to sing with this chick, but then that thing, not going to happen. So after I calmed down, I realized that we might be able to make something happen. So Hintz and I and Robert, we got in the studio and played some changes and made some things happen with the track that became attractive. Then we brought Ruth along and we sung that song and it jumped way up in the charts. So Frank said, man, we got something going now. We really got something going. So Robert said, okay, so we're gonna do original music now, right? He said, bring the song. So by the time we finished, we got the recipe was on the backside of Easy Lovin'. Then we had a song that a guy named Charles Gentry wrote called Love in This Room Tonight.
I feel love. This room tonight. I feel love in this room tonight.
another song he wrote called Train of Desire. And then he had one called To Make You Love Me. So we said, whoa, we'll just go do these songs. Again, we were just about to wrap up the album, but we kept saying, you know what? We need something to drive this album. These are great songs. Good work, nicely done. But we need something that's going to make people stop and say, whoa, what just happened? So Robert was telling a story, and I said, oh, you're going to get next to me. He said, yeah, that's what I was saying. I said, no, that's what I said. He said, don't be funny, man. Let's write this. So because we had to figure out how to be male and female, we wrote about a woman who didn't want to settle down, who said, well, if you keep on doing what you're doing, I might want to settle down. Then we met a dude who said, well, she's strange because she don't come down the street alley. I come down that street like I used to see her coming down the street. And we started to sing those melodies. And man, Robert then got into his arranging mode. He said, man, we're going to do something ain't nobody ever done before. I said, what's that? He said, we're going to make... And we're going to do all the woodwinds with solos individually. So I'm going to start with the flute. I'm going to go all the way to the tenor saxophone. I said, okay, let's try it. Sure enough, by the time he got with the flute, out of the flute, he started with a piccolo. Went from the piccolo to the flute. From the flute to the alto, from the alto to the tenor, he had turned the record industry upside down. And hence, did some voicing on the horns, man. It was crazy. And of course, James Gadson and Al McKay, Ron Brown, it changed people's thoughts about what disco really was.
But if you keep on doing what you do, you're gonna get next to me. Keep on doing what you do, you're gonna get next to me. If you keep on doing what you do, you're gonna get next to me. Keep on doing what you do.
And now, new generations of fans have been introduced to Mike James Kirkland's music. In addition to hip-hop artists sampling his music, Mike James Kirkland's music also appears on movie soundtracks and TV shows.
We've had several places. As a matter of fact, Roxanne had one of our songs. The House of Cards had There's Nothing I Can Do About It. Honestly, I don't know, this may sound funny, but I can't remember all the movies. Oh, Muhammad Ali, there was a movie called Facing Ali. We were the soundtrack for that movie, Facing Ali. It's been quite an interesting venture.
Mike and the Censations, Mike James Kirkland, Bo Kirkland, no matter what moniker he goes by, one thing's clear. Legacy artist Mike James Kirkland and his brother Robert definitely won that bet.
Once I was a victim of circumstance, thinking that there's nothing that I could do about it,
that I could do about it.
But you came along and told me to hang on in there, and that's when I knew
were gonna get next to me. Tra la la, la 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 la. Flashback, remembering our times together. Flashback, feeling that will last forever and ever. Flashback, oh baby, remembering you and me. Flashback, 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 flashback. You introduced me to a sweet romance. And oh girl, now I can't live without it. I can't live. You showed me just how sweet love can be, while showing me just how much you care. Flashback, oh baby, baby, remembering our times together. Flashback, you and me, forever and ever. Oh girl, flashback, baby, 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 baby. Flashback, is this some kind of new mind control? Flashback, you have me under your control. Flashback, baby, baby. Flashback, sweet memories together. Oh girl,